गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू. टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस मिसलेनियस सेक्शन ऑफ योर टेक्स्ट बुक इन विच आई विल बी डिस्कसिंग टॉपिक्स लाइक सोल्डरिंग एंड वेल्डिंग, जेनेटिक्स इन ऑर्थोडॉन्टिक्स, कंप्यूटर्स इन ऑर्थोडॉन्टिक्स, रिमूवेबल क्लियर अप्लायंसेज, रोल ऑफ ऑर्थोडॉन्टिस्ट इन स्नोरिंग एंड स्लीप एपनिया, कॉम्प्लिकेशंस एंड लिमिटेशंस ऑफ ऑर्थोडॉन्टिक्स. द फर्स्ट टॉपिक इज सोल्डरिंग एंड वेल्डिंग. It is not always possible to create a metal device in one piece, such as by casting. So it is necessary to assemble it from separately prepared parts, that is, joining two metal pieces with various techniques. In dentistry, the fabrication techniques used are either soldering or welding. The terms used are soldering, brazing, and welding. You all must have seen integrated circuits of electronic devices in which number of small joints are there. This is an example of soldering, and these are the soldered joints. It is defined as the joining of metals by a fusion of filler metal between them at a temperature below the solidus temperature of the metals being joined and below 450 degrees centigrade. So an additional filler material is required to join two metal parts, and it is a term used in industrial work. Soldering operations at or above 450 degrees centigrade is generally termed brazing. The American National Standards Institute currently is considering a proposal to call all operations in dentistry as brazing rather than soldering. As the temperature exceeds 450 degrees centigrade in dental lab procedures, appropriate term is brazing rather than soldering. Most dental soldering procedures are actually brazing, but the names are used interchangeably in dentistry. Brazing is defined as joining of metals by a fusion of filler metal between them. Here it is same as soldering, but the difference is at a temperature below the solidus temperature of the metals being joined and above 450 degrees centigrade. In soldering, it was less than 450 degrees centigrade, but here it is more than 450 degrees centigrade. The solder joint consists of the following components. First is parent metal, that is the metals to be joined, fluxes and antifluxes. Third is solder or the filler metal. The parent metal is the metal or alloy to be joined. It is also known as substrate metal or base metal. Soldering operation is the same for any substrate oxide that forms on the surface during heating solder. When we heat any metal, an oxide layer is formed on the surface of that metal, which doesn't allow the two pieces to join. The composition of parent metal determines the wettability of the substrate by the molten metal during melting. Coming to flux, as in the previous slide we have discussed, during heating of metal, oxide layer is formed on it, which prevents its joining. Flux helps in removing the oxidized layer from the surfaces of the metal to be joined. Secondly, it seals out air, thus preventing further oxidation, and it improves the wetting characteristics of the molten or liquid solder, or we can say that it improves the flow of the solder. Now, classification of fluxes are, first is according to their primary purpose. It is type 1, surface protection, type 2, reducing agent, type 3, solvent. According to pH of the flux, acidic flux, silicon dioxide, basic flux, calcium oxide, lime, that is calcium carbonate or limestone, neutrals, fluorspar, borax. Based on boric or borate compounds, type 1 protective fluxes by forming a low temperature glass, type 2 reducing fluxes, low stability oxides such as copper oxide, type 3 fluoride flux. And here the composition is boric acid is 25 to 35%, potassium fluoride 50 to 60%, potassium carbonate 8 to 10%. Some fluoride containing fluxes involve toxic fluorides when heated, So inhalation of fumes should be avoided. Coming to anti-flux, these are the materials used to restrict the flow of solder. It is applied on the specific area of the metal where the flux should flow. So it acts as a barrier, or we can say it limits the flow of flux or solder within its margins. For example, graphite in the form of lead pencil. But disadvantage of graphite is that it can burn off on prolonged heating at high temperature. In such case, whiting calcium carbonate in alcohol and water suspension can be used. And pre-mixed anti-flux pastes are also available. Coming to filler metal, that is solder, a rule of thumb is that the flow temperature of the filler metal, that is solder, should be 56 degrees centigrade or 100 degrees Fahrenheit, lower than the solidus temperature of the substrate metal. It means that solder or filler metal should melt first before melting of the parent metals to be joined. The flame has been divided into four zones: oxidizing zone, reducing zone, partial combustion zone, and cold mixing zone. The zone which is used for soldering is the reducing zone, as it is having the highest temperature. Methods of soldering are infrared soldering, oven soldering, freehand soldering, investment soldering. And in orthodontics, most of the times we use freehand soldering. Now coming to applications, first is wire to wire, as shown in the first picture. An additional piece of wire can be soldered onto the main arch wire for force application. Molar tube can be soldered to the bridge of the Adam's clasp. As you must have read in the modifications of Adam's clasp, it is one of the modifications. Attachment of springs to the arch wire, the solder must be gold solder with the melting point below 800 degrees centigrade. Normally we use silver solder. But if we want to attach some spring to the arch wire, then we have to use gold solder, that is a filler metal. Soldering lingual arch or palatal arch, as shown in the picture, transpalatal arch is soldered with both the molar bands on the palatal side. Now the next procedure is welding. It is the fusion of two metals of similar metal under pressure without the introduction of third material. It means no filler material is required in welding. The metal must be softened by heat as well as compressed to achieve this. There are two types of welding, cold welding and hot welding. In cold welding, it is done by hammering or pressure. An example of cold welding is gold foil filling. In this, two metal pieces are placed under pressure with which they are fused with each other. In hot welding, it uses heat of sufficient intensity to melt the metals being joined. The heat source is usually an oxyacetylene flame or high amperage electricity. In this process, the two metal pieces are heated and melted. In the melting stage, they are fused or joined with each other. Now, principle of welding, it works on the principle of pressure and heat. Welds are made by passing an electric current through the pieces to be joined, which are pressed together tightly. The resistance offered by stainless steel to an electric current of high amperage generates enough heat to soften it. You all must have seen this equipment named spot welder in orthodontics department. For example, if we want to weld a molar tube on this molar band, that molar tube is assembled on the band first, and this assembly is placed under these two copper electrodes. Between electrodes, molar tube is placed with pressure against the band. When current is passed by pressing the button on the spot welder, heat is generated, which melts these two components which are under the electrodes. so they get fused by application of pressure and heat. Methods of spot welding are spot welding, pressure welding, laser welding, oxyacetylene, arch welding. In orthodontics, we use spot welding with the help of spot welder. Applications of spot welding in orthodontics are stainless steel strip for making molar bands, securing attachments to the bands, attaching springs to a rigid bow wire or to bands. It is used more in the construction of fixed appliances than removal appliances. Next topic is genetics in orthodontics. Genetics is a science concerned with the structure and function of all genes in different organisms. Founder of human genetics is Joseph Adams and father of modern genetics is Gregor Mendel. Now, why genetics is required in orthodontics? Growth, development, and function of oral and facial structure of an individual depends on his genes. Genetics shed light on all these questions. An orthodontist should know exactly why or how a malocclusion occurs, to what extent it expresses on next generation, what is its prevalence, and how it reacts to the treatment plan, and mostly if it can be prevented. It helps to segregate inherited malocclusions or abrasions of growth from those due to effect of environmental factors. Thus helps us to diagnose and prevent it from occurring in next generation. About mode of transmission of malocclusions. First is repetitive traits. The recurrence of a single dentofacial deviation within the immediate family and in the progenitors. The same trait is seen generation after generation. That is, malocclusion is repeating in every next generation. Discontinuous traits. It is the recurrence of a malocclusion that reappears within a family over several generations but not continuously. That is, malocclusion is not repeating immediately but after some generations. Variable traits. The occurrence of different but related types of malocclusions within several generations. For example, missing teeth. Same teeth may not be missing in different generations. About genetic influence in orthodontics, this is a list of dentofacial disturbances of genetic origin. Coming to Butler's field theory, Butler divided the mammalian dentition into several development fields. It includes molar-premolar field, canine and incisor field. Among the fields, the maximum variability manifests itself in the distal and the least in the mesial direction. That is, farther the region, maximum is the variability. That's why third molar shows maximum variation in size and shape of crown, as well as size and number of roots also. Even if we compare lateral incisor with the central incisor, variability would be more in lateral incisor as it is away from the midline when compared with the central incisor. So the whole summary of this theory is, tooth which is more distally placed from the midline, it would show maximum variation. Coming to twin studies, it is done to evaluate the role of genetics played in various traits. Now, there are two terms, monozygotic and dizygotic. Monozygotic means the twins are derived from a single ovum, hence they are identical. In dizygotic, the twins are derived from two separate ovum and hence they are not identical. If both the individuals of the monozygotic twins express a trait that is seen in the parent, it is a strong evidence for a very significant role of genetics in that particular trait. In case only one of the monozygotic twins express the trait and the other is absolutely normal, then we come to the conclusion that although there is a genetic component in the disease, there are some other factors which control the disease, that is multifactorial trait. Depending on the presence or absence of a particular trait, twins can be classified into concordant and discordant twins. If a particular character is seen in both the members, they are said to be concordant. If only one member of the pair expresses a trait, they are said to be discordant. Cleft studies suggest that the concordance rate in monozygotic twins, the twins which are derived from a single ovum, shows cleft lip was 35% and that for cleft palate was 26%. In dizygotic twins, where they are derived from a two separate ovum, the concordance rate for cleft lip was 5% and that for cleft palate was 6%. This reflects the heritability of the condition. The higher the monozygotic concordance, the more important is the genetic contribution. This is an example of monozygotic twins. If we compare the maxillary arch of the first kid with the second one, there is spacing present between the incisors in the first kid, but here there is a mild crowding. If we compare the occlusion in the vertical plane, deep bite is present in both the kids. Occlusion is almost normal in both the kids. So this is an example of monozygotic twins. The occlusion is almost identical. This is an example of dizygotic twins. If we compare the maxillary arch of both the kids, here the anterior segment is well aligned. But in the second kid, the canine is blocked out. Now if we are comparing the mandibular arch of both the kids, crowding is present in the anterior segment in the first one, but here crowding is seen in the posterior segment. And in the vertical plane, deep bite is seen in the first one and bite is almost normal in the second one. So malocclusion is not identical in dizygotic twins. So twin studies reveal that genetic variation has a major effect on arch width and length. Identical twins were not occlusally identical. Greater genetic basis for tooth size and shape. Known dimensions were largely under genetic control. Next topic is computers in orthodontics. Computers have simplified clinical, laboratory, and record maintenance work a lot. Applications are divided into three groups: administrative, clinical, and others. Nowadays, number of companies have computer software for maintenance of patient records, their appointments including accounts work, which has simplified the practice. Patient appointment and recalls, billing, accounting, correspondence, inventory control and supply orders, that is stock maintenance, dental insurance claims, document preparation, and referral information. Under clinical applications, patient record storage and retrieval, patient evaluation, examination and treatment planning, patient motivation, appliance designing by CAD/CAM, computerized imaging, computerized cephalometry, computerized growth predictions, clinical diagnosis and treatment planning. All these applications have reduced the paperwork and also reduced time of the operator for preparing the database for treatment planning. Other applications include database for survey information, continuing medical or dental education, reviewing of literature, research, case presentations, conference presentations, entertainment and family use. Now coming to digital photographs. It eliminates the use of films. It allows to view the photographs on the spot. We can share the photograph instantly with the patient. It reduces film development cost and inexpensive storage, manipulation and editing capabilities, streamline interpersonal communication. Coming to RVG, that is radio visiography, it is latest X-ray technology in dentistry. Digital radio visiograph is equipped with special image analysis software, and in digital technology, it is possible to enlarge the images and their saving in the patient's file. As no developing or fixing as in IOPA is required, it reduces the chair side time of the operator. All the images are stored in the computer itself in the patient's folder within the software. Even if the patient is coming after years to us, all the radiographic images of previous treatment can be seen. Digital cephalogram or digitizing cephalogram, conversion of analog information into digital form, reduces radiation exposure by a factor of 2, gives better radiation protection. In this, a sensor is there which requires less radiation exposure but giving us a better resolution of radiograph as compared to conventional radiograph. Hard and soft tissue landmarks are clearly visible, which are not as clear in conventional cephalograms. Advantages: reduced radiation of the patient compared with classic X-ray up to 80%, faster imaging without X-ray film and developing images, digital intraoral sensor is used instead of X-ray film, immediate imaging on the computer screen, high quality of digital image that can be analyzed and processed, saving images in the patient's file. Then software for cephalometric tracing. Rapid advances in computer science have led to the wide application of computers in cephalometry. After digitizing lateral cephalogram, ceph tracing is done with the help of this software. For treatment planning, patient's lateral photograph is superimposed on patient's lateral cephalogram to check the soft tissue changes by virtually distalizing or mesializing anterior or posterior segments, whatever we have planned for the treatment. This software gives us an image whether the profile of the patient would become pleasing or would become worse with the tooth movement that we have done virtually. Accordingly, we can plan the movement of teeth which improve the profile or soft tissue relation of the patient. Coming to DigiGraph, it was introduced by Dolphin Imaging Systems. It's a non-radiographic system. In this, a DigiGraph workstation is required as shown in the picture. Video images are also possible and it reduces time required for records. It's an alternative method of cephalometric tracing in which no lateral cephalogram is required. In this system, anatomic landmarks are directly marked on the patient's face with the help of a digital sensor, and those landmarks are recorded on the patient's lateral photograph in the computer with the help of this software. In this way, tracing is done. Coming to AuthoCAD, it is a method of digitizing study models. It is a digital study model capture, assessment and storage system. It provides a 3D record of the original malocclusion, any stages during treatment and the outcome of treatment. CAD-CAM system, that is computer-aided design or computer-aided manufacturing systems, useful for the diagnostic setup of cast for orthodontic diagnosis and treatment planning. This system comprises a measuring unit which obtains 3D information from the dental model using laser scanning and a personal computer to generate the 3D graphics. Applications: it is helpful in making diagnostic models, treatment planning, determination of amount of tooth movement. For example, virtually we can extract a tooth or teeth in an arch, move the teeth in a mesial or distal direction, and check the outcome of movement of teeth, whether it is favorable or not. Mock surgical setup can be done with this software. Alignment of tooth or teeth can be checked, movement of the dental arch, and finally bracket positioning. By virtually bonding brackets at various levels on the surface, it will show us the movement of the teeth according to the bracket position. Rest of the topics I'll discuss in the next presentation. Thank you.